our next task is going to be to try to give an account of language. Now, it might seem a bit presumptuous to think that we need to spend a lot of time on language, because the greatest achievements, I think, of philosophy of the past 100 years or so have been in the philosophy of language.
The good school was told you.
Beginning really with Frege, who invented the philosophy of language in its modern sense, and continuing right on through to the present day, it seems to me our greatest achievements have been in the philosophy of language, with perhaps one notable exception, and that is Rawls' reinvention of the subject of political philosophy, and therefore the subject of ethics, with the publication of his book, A Theory of Justice, in, when was it, 71 or 72. But with that one exception, I think our greatest philosophers have been in the philosophy of language. All the same, though I think it's a terrific set of achievements, there's something unsatisfying about our accounts of language. And I can put that by saying that it seems to me they're insufficiently naturalistic. They do not treat human language as an extension of humans' pre-linguistic biological capacities. Indeed, some philosophers have even said, well, you can't have mental capacities without language. Davidson said animals can't have beliefs and desires. As I said yesterday, I don't think he ever met Gilbert, my dog, but in any case, that's a common view. And Fodor thinks that, well, in order to have any thought, you've got to have language, because you couldn't think a thought unless you had some language to think it in. And if animals have thoughts, it must be because they've got a kind of built-in language of thought. And then he thinks that's how we learn language, because we translate, when we're infants, we learn to translate the words we hear into this basic, pre-linguistic, biologically given Ursprache, this basic language of thought. Now, I think that's unscientific, and I'm going to urge a different approach in this lecture. And the approach that I'm going to urge is to say that we ought to treat human language as an extension, as a natural evolutionary development of pre-linguistic biological capacities. We ought to treat our human capacity for language as an essentially a continuation of our non-linguistic, pre-linguistic, biological, mental capacities. And the result that I'm going to work toward, what's going to emerge, if I'm right, is that language is a lot more social than philosophers have given it credit for, but not social in just any old kind of way, but social in a way that makes society, human society, essentially linguistic. If you look at the standard textbook accounts of language that you get in the philosophy and in the linguistics courses, we're told that a human language such as a Swedish or French or English consists of three components. It consists of a phonological component that determines how the words are pronounced. It determines a syntactical component that determines how the words and morphemes are arranged into sentences. And it determines, it contains a semantic component that determines what the words and therefore the sentences mean. Now, more sophisticated accounts will add a pragmatic component, which is not specific to any particular language. And we'll see that that's important, because we will find that in order to develop the semantics, you get very definite pragmatic implications. Notice that my question that forms my title is not what is a language, such as French or Swedish. I will not be interested in what distinguishes French from Swedish. But my question is the more general question, what is language? Now, if we look at the standard accounts that I was mentioning, we will find that the account of syntax, and it's an account that I agree with, says that the syntax of language has three quite remarkable features. Namely, the syntactical elements are discrete. And that means they come in discrete units and they preserve their unity under transformation. Furthermore, the syntax is compositional and it is generative. It's compositional in that the sentence is composed of the elements of which constitute the sentence according to the rules of construction for that particular language, and is generative in the sense that the rules of any natural human language determine that you can form, potentially at least, an infinite number of sentences. Now I want to slow down and consider each of these features briefly. It's very important that the elements of a language are discrete in the sense you can't, unlike baking a cake, for example, they don't get all mushed together. You can have a sentence with 7 words or a sentence with 10 words, but you can't have a sentence with 8.5 words. Whereas you can make a cake by adding half a cup more, and then it all gets mushed together. But the words and the morphemes, they preserve their identity under transformation. They are discrete units. Compositionality has both a syntactical and a semantic aspect. Syntactically, as I said, the sentence is a function of its elements together with the rules of combination. But of course, semantically, the meaning of the sentence is determined not just by the meanings of the components, but by how they're combined into the syntax of the sentence. So we all hear the sentence, John loves Mary, differently than the way we hear the sentence, Mary loves John. They have the same elements, but they are combined differently. And generativity, of course, gives us this possibility for an infinite number of sentences and consequently an infinite number of discrete sentential meanings in any natural human language. Well, what's wrong with that account? I mean, it sounds pretty good to me. What it leaves out, and what I'm going to argue is essential to understanding language as an extension of our pre-linguistic biological capacity, what it leaves out is the special role of commitment. The special role of the way in which our utterances commit us. We undertake obligations, rights, responsibilities, duties, authorizations, permissions. And just to have a general term, I'm going to use this ugly Greek-based expression. I'm going to say, you will not understand the special feature of human language if you don't see that it has built-in deontology. I'm sorry for the ugliness of the word, but ugly words tend to be memorable. You won't forget. It isn't just rights and obligations, but it's the whole big shebang of rights, duties, obligations, and all the rest of it. And that's what I'm going to be working toward. And it's going to turn out that that's essential because language doesn't just describe the reality we live in, but where society is concerned, it creates that reality. There's no such thing as money, property, government, and marriage, not to mention cocktail parties, summer vacations, and lecture series in Lund without language. You can have language without having money, property, government, and marriage, but you cannot have money or property or government or summer vacations or lawyers and doctors and cocktail parties without language. Now that's going to be very important for our whole project. Okay, so that's what my misgiving about how the standard linguistic textbooks approach language. But I have a deeper misgiving about how social theorists approach language. There is an exasperating feature of our social philosophy extending from Plato and Aristotle right up to Habermas and Michel Foucault. In a sense, they all take language for granted. You see, they assume we've got all these people talking, and then they want to know how does it work. But what I want to know is how the hell did those people get to be talking in the first place, and what's involved in that? The worst offenders in my regard are the social contract theorists. The social contract theorists think all these people get together and have a nice talk and then decide, what the hell, let's make a contract, let's have a society. But notice, they assume language. And what I want to say is, if you've got language, you've already got a social contract. There's a social contract built into the very existence of human linguistic communication. Okay, so our basic question then is, I don't know how to approach this. But here's one way that I'm going to try. Let's think of it as an engineering question, a designer question. You got all these beasts, and they're running around on the face of the earth, and they're pretty smart, but they haven't yet got language. They got consciousness and intentionality and all that stuff I talked about yesterday, but they don't have language. Now, what do they have to have in order to have language? And I'm going to put that as an evolutionary question. How could language have evolved from pre-linguistic cognitive capacities? But when I ask that question and when I give an answer, I'm not engaging in a speculative evolutionary biology. We don't have any fossil evidence. What I'm doing is a kind of logical thought experiment. What features have to be added to pre-linguistic cognitive capacities in order to get to language? And I'll put that as a thought experiment about evolution. How could language have evolved? But it's not my aim to give you an empirical account about how language did evolve, because I said we don't know. But we do know that it did evolve, and for that reason, it is important for us to answer the question, how could it have evolved? And so the question, though it's a thought experiment, is not unrealistic. There was a time when there were a lot of beasts that looked an awful lot like us. They were hairier, but they looked a lot like us, and they were running around on the surface of the earth, and they didn't have a language, and now they've got languages. And how? I mean, by the hundreds, and even with all the dying languages, still it's got over a couple thousand remaining. I don't know how to count dialects. You know, people say a language is a dialect that has an army. I have not been able to figure out what is the linguistic distinction that distinguishes a Danish from Swedish from Norwegian. But in any case, we've got a lot of languages. How could they have evolved? Okay, in order to answer that question, it seems to me we've got to list the features that language and pre-linguistic cognitive capacities have in common. And then we've got to list the features that consciousness has but language does not have. And then finally, we've got to list the features that language has that are not features of consciousness and pre-linguistic intentionality in order to see how they might have evolved. Okay, well, let's just go to work. I said yesterday that if you've got a beast that has consciousness of the kind that we have, it already has intentionality. It's got this remarkable capacity that human and animal minds have to relate the organism to the rest of the world by way of representing it in perception, thought, belief, intention, hopes, fear, and all the rest of it. Now, those intentional states, like beliefs and desires, have a certain structure. They have the structure of the type of state that it is together with its content. So I can believe that someone is leaving. I can fear that someone is leaving. I can hope that someone is leaving. Same content, different type of state. But of course, that distinction is familiar from the theory of speech acts. We get exactly that distinction in the distinction between my telling you, please leave the room, asking you, will you leave the room, and predicting you will leave the room. In each of those three cases, you have the same propositional content, but presented with different, it uses technical jargon, different illocutionary force, presented in a different type of speech act. And the theory of speech acts is largely about this structure, and what I'm going to be talking about today is how you get from this structure to that structure, where you have a thought that has a content that comes to you in a certain mode, and how you get to a speech act that can have that content, but it's presented as an action and not as a thought. Now, there's one huge difference, of course, and that is that these guys up here are actions. They're things you do. You make statements, ask questions, give commands, orders, promises, apologies, thanks, and all the rest of it. And these here are not actions. These are things that occur as mental representations. They are beliefs, hopes, fears, and desires. Okay, so, but that's one thing that we've got in common between the speech act and the intentional state, and that's going to be important when we try to build a bridge between consciousness and pre-linguistic consciousness and language. Now, another thing that's going to be crucial is this. Both language and pre-linguistic thought has different ways of relating to reality. Beliefs and statements relate to reality by representing how it is or how it's supposed to be. And I think in very simple metaphors, I say they have the mind or language to world direction of fit. If I say it's raining, then my statement or my belief is supposed to represent how things are in the world, is supposed to fit the world. But desires and intentions, like orders and promises, do not have that direction of fit. They have this direction of fit. The world is supposed to change to match the content of the mind or the contents of the language, as the case might be. So, and these directions of fit are also present in pre-linguistic cognitive capacities. The difference between wanting something to be the case and believing that it is the case, and that's going to be crucial as we see how to get from these structures to these structures. Now, there's an interesting feature of language that you do not get in pre-linguistic thought processes, and it's going to be it's a remarkable feature of language, and it's going to be important in the story that I tell you. And that is, language in a very peculiar class of cases has the capacity to achieve both directions of fit at once. You can make something the case and thus achieve the world to world to mind direction of fit, or world to word direction of fit. You can make something the case by representing it as being the case. That is, by the downhill or mind-to-world direction of fit. And those things have this double direction of fit. The most famous examples are performative utterances, where the guy says, "I hereby adjourn the meeting," and thus he creates a new state of affairs. The meeting is adjourned. But of course, he adjourned the meeting by representing it as being adjourned. "I now pronounce you husband and wife. War is declared. I hereby promise to come and see you on Wednesday." All of those are cases where I make something the case. I change the world to match reality. And so I get this uphill direction of fit. But I do it by representing the world as already having that feature. I create a reality by representing that reality as existing. And you can only do that with language. And it's a very special power of language. Pre-linguistic intentionality does not have that power. Now, these things here have a special name. The special vocabulary for assessing success in achieving this direction of fit, the downhill, or mind language to world direction of fit, is true and false. If you can literally say that it's true or false, then it's likely to be something that has the downhill or mind-to-world direction of fit, because you're representing how things are, as opposed to promises and orders, where you don't represent how they are, but how you're trying to make them be, or desires and intentions, which don't represent how they are, but how you'd like them to be, or how you intend to make them to be. Okay, so those are the features that we're going to build on to try to get from the pre-linguistic cognitive capacities to linguistic forms of cognition. Now, what are the features that consciousness has that language lacks? We're going to be talking about some features that language has that consciousness doesn't have. But now I want to point out to some very important features of consciousness which are going to be useful when we evolve language. And one is, in consciousness, the traditional philosophical problem about the unity of the proposition, you got all these words in the proposition, but how do they hang together into unity? That question doesn't arise for consciousness, because in consciousness, you've already got a unified state of affairs. You already see that such and such is the case. And in order to see that, I need to introduce another concept here, and that is the pre-linguistic cognitive capacities already have the ability to represent conditions of satisfaction. So what stands to the beliefs being true will stand to the desires being fulfilled or the intentions being carried out, and those are exactly parallel to the statements being true, the orders being obeyed, or the promise being kept. So we might say both the pre-linguistic forms of intentionality and the linguistic forms represent their conditions of satisfaction. But in consciousness, in conscious thought processes that are pre-linguistic and conscious perceptions that are pre-linguistic, that the conditions of satisfaction are not broken up into elements in the way that they are with language. Furthermore, and this is going to be crucial as well, the conditions of satisfaction that you get in these cases already in the case of consciousness present objects as salient. They present objects and their features as salient. So you don't just see the world as an undifferentiated mass, but you see it as already coming in discrete objects with their features. Now, if you think of the resources now that the animal brings to bear, now, prior to having language, they're quite remarkable resources. Because we got all this apparatus in the pre-linguistic form. The animal has beliefs and desires and perceptions and intention. Those have different directions of fit and different conditions of satisfaction. But then if you think more about animal consciousness, and now I go back to my dog Gilbert, who is my walking laboratory of animal consciousness. Gilbert, though he doesn't know this, has a rather large number of the traditional philosophical categories. I know he hasn't got any concepts corresponding to that, but he's already got the concepts of space and time. He's already got the categories of space and time. He doesn't have the concepts. He doesn't have any concepts of time. But he's got categories of space and time because he experiences the world in a spatial and temporal fashion. He knows that he's here and his dog dish is over there. He knows that first he gets fed this food and then secondly he gets fed that food. He's got the concept of object and identity. He can believe it or not, he can recognize me as the same guy time after time, even though I have on different clothes and I appear at different times of the day or night. So he's got such notions as individuation, object, identity through change, object and properties, because he can see that one and the same object undergoes change of properties. It moves from over here to over there. And furthermore, he's got the idea, he's got the category, the concept, that the object persists through time because he can recognize the same object at different times. He recognizes the same person as that person. Okay, so that's the apparatus that we've got. Now, what is it that language has that pre-linguistic cognitive capacities do not have? And it seems to me one of the most remarkable features about language, which you do not get in pre-linguistic cognitive capacities, is internal and controllable structures. You see, Gilbert can believe, he can perceive and therefore believe someone is approaching the door. How do I know that? He really cuts loose. He's a Bernese mountain dog and they are famous for the vehemence of their barking when somebody's approaching the house. He can see and believe that someone is approaching the door. But notice he can't distinguish the thought, someone is approaching the door, from the passive, the door is being approached by someone. And I doubt if he can even form the false thought, the door is approaching someone. And he certainly can't form the thought, I wish someone would approach the door next Wednesday afternoon. Much less the thought, I wish we'd all go to the zoo on Christmas Day because I'm tired of hanging around the house looking at humans. He just can't do those things. And even when he's got thoughts that we would describe as, he can think someone is approaching the door. He cannot break that thought into the components which he can then manipulate. See, language gives us this remarkable capacity that we can manipulate and thus form thought, not only thoughts that are true, but thoughts that are false and indeed thoughts that are impossible. Gilbert cannot think there are a million people approaching the door all at once. It's an impossible. It's a thought about an impossible state of affairs, but he can't do that, and we can do that when we have these internal and controllable structures. Now, furthermore, and this, I think, is a consequence of what I just said, this is the second feature where a language differs from pre-linguistic thought, and that is what I would call structure and segmentation. The structures that I told you about are segmented into these discrete syntactical units. And language is essentially segmented in a way that pre-linguistic conscious experience is not. Is the metaphor that philosophers use of the stream of consciousness, I think, is a good metaphor. You wake up in the morning and you're in the stream of consciousness that continues throughout the day. But the stream is a continuous, unbroken stream, even though, as I said, objects and their properties are salient. But where you get language, the sentences and the words that make up the sentences are discrete entities. Each speech act is, in a sense, timeless, because though it may take me longer to say a sentence than somebody who talks faster, the amount of time that it takes is not essential to the identity of that speech act. Whereas where conscious thought experiences are concerned, they are essentially temporal and essentially unsegmented in the fashion that speech acts are segmented. They have a special relationship. The speech act has an internal unity to it, which we're going to have to explain, but it is not an unsegmented continuous element with the rest of our experience. It stands as discrete and made up of these separate discrete entities that, as I said earlier, do not lose their identity under transformation. Okay. Now, I think some of that may sound a bit unclear, but I'm going to try to make it clearer when we talk about how we get from the pre-linguistic to the linguistic. But in order to do that, we've got to answer another question. What functions does language perform for us that we're going to see evolving from our pre-linguistic cognitive capacities? And in order to clarify that question, I have to make a distinction between what I'll call representation versus expression. There are lots of communicative acts that are purely expressive. When Gilbert barks aggressively, he expresses his anger or whatever the appropriate emotion is. He expresses his feelings toward possible intruders. But he doesn't represent anything. But if an animal has the capacity to signal something like the presence of danger or rain or food, then those represent something. Those represent something as being the case. And of course, the most famous animals in this regard are the bee language. They definitely represent that the nectar exists at a certain distance from the hive and a certain direction away from the hive. They have elements that are in a minimal way compositional for conveying these representations. Now, I am arbitrarily going to say that what we're interested in is not the expressive function of language, but the representational function of language. And the mark is, do you get a fit? Do you get a direction of fit, either true or false, or kept or broken, or obeyed or disobeyed? Do you have a matching relationship between the content of the proposition and the reality, whether or not it's actually true, whether or not the reality does match the context of the proposition? Okay, now let's then focus on representation and notice that there are some interesting features of the pre-linguistic animal. One is, with very few exceptions, they don't seem to be able to manage compositionality. In the famous chimpanzee case, where they try to teach the chimpanzee certain primitive English sentences, the problem is that the chimpanzee can't distinguish between Coco want banana want Coco, and want Coco banana. It's all the same to her. She just wants a banana. She doesn't divide it up into these discrete units. But let's imagine now, we've got these beasts. They've got all this pre-linguistic cognitive apparatus, and they're going to involve the kind of stuff that I've been talking about as having these special features that human language has, structure and segmentation in particular. how might they do it? Okay. Well, that, now we go to the second part. I'm going to have a drink of water to catch my breath. Now, again, I'm always grateful that people are willing to listen to a lecture in a language that's not their native tongue. I couldn't do it myself. I admire it enormously. But I want to make sure I'm not going too fast and everybody's with us. And the room's kind of crowded. Can everybody hear at the back? Don't drink from that glass. Swedes are famous for politeness. I think in other countries people would have rushed up and torn it away from them. All right, so here we go. Now let's imagine that you've got these beasts that evolve signals. And again, that's not science fiction because that actually happens. I mean, we know that animals have pre-linguistic forms of signaling and they can signal that such and such is the case. But now notice all of these would correspond to one word sentences. They would correspond to sentences like rain or danger or food or fire. They would signal what Peter Strawson called in a book he wrote a long time ago, 1959, what he called feature place. And these would be one word sentences that function to identify the presence of a feature in the situation. They pick out a certain state of affairs. But so far, we don't have any structure. But we've got this feature placing. Now, how does that work? Well, if it's done intentionally, and we don't know what's going on in the minds of actual animals, but in our imagined hominids who are evolving language, if that's done intentionally, then there is a remarkable capacity that these utterances have, a remarkable feature. And that is, in a perfectly ordinary sense of the English word meaning, they are meaningful. The speaker, as we will call the animal, actually means something by the utterance. He means that it is raining, that there is danger present, that there is fire here, that there is food here. He actually means something by the utterance. Now, what does that involve? Let me tell you, I don't know how it is in Swedish, but there's no more troublesome word in philosophy in English than the word meaning. Possible exception is mind. Mind is a lot of hassle, too. And it's interesting to me, I don't know many languages, but in the two I know a little bit about, mind and meaning neither translates into French or German. They're just a special kind of weird confusion that English speakers have. So whenever I write a book that has the word mind in the title, translators are always embarrassed. And who wants to have a word, have a book published with the word Geist on the cover? It doesn't sound so bad to me as it does to Germans, but now I've got to the point where it sounds bad to me. It sounds like ghosts or something. And it's just as bad in French, esprit. I mean, who wants to write a book, a philosophy of the spirit, for God's sake? So mind and meaning are troublesome, but now we're not going to talk about every kind of meaning. We're not going to talk about meaning in the sense in which you mean a lot to me, Sally. Or life has become meaningless since the income tax rates went up. I'm not going to talk about those. I'm going to talk about a very special kind of meaning where, yes, when you perform an action, you wave your hand as a signal, or you say something through your mouth, and you mean something by it. And I want to say, for all the complexities of meaning, this one has a very simple structure. What's the difference between me raising my hand, just to raise my hand, just for the hell of it, and me raising my hand as a signal that something is the case? I'm signaling that something is the case to somebody else. The enemy is coming, let's say. I signal that by raising my hand. What's the difference? And I think the difference is very clear, that in a case where I signal by raising my hand, I mean something by it in a way that I did not mean anything by it when I just raised my hand. And now, and this is the crucial point, when I mean something by it, what I do is impose conditions of satisfaction on the gesture. the gesture can now be true or false. If I intentionally impose meaning, what I'm doing is imposing conditions of satisfaction on the raising of my arm. But the raising of my arm was itself the condition of satisfaction of the intention to raise it. So what I have done when I perform a meaningful act, a meaningful speech act, is impose conditions of satisfaction on conditions of satisfaction. Now, if you got that, you're ahead of most professional philosophers. As an author, you can't get it. But I'm gonna say it again, I reassure myself that I've got it. The whole distinction between gestures that where you don't mean anything and gestures where you do mean something in this representational sense we're talking about is your gestures, your actions now acquire meaning. But that means they acquire conditions of satisfaction. But since the bodily movements were themselves the condition of satisfaction of the intention to perform them, then meaning is identical with the intentional imposition of conditions of satisfaction on conditions of satisfaction. It's that simple in the end. Now, how it gets articulated into actual human language, as we all know, is incredibly complicated. Think what it is like to try to translate Mallarmé into colloquial English, or colloquial Swedish. I'm not trying to simplify actual languages. I think they are unbelievably complicated. What I'm trying to do is strip them down to the bare bones of the components that enable them to exist at all. And this is the first crucial notion we're going to have to introduce on the way to language. The first step is the creation of speaker meaning. And we know that pre-linguistic animals can do that. We know that the bees do it. And we know, maybe they're not pre-linguistic, but we know that all kinds of animals have systems whereby they can represent that something is the case. All right, now then, it's not unreasonable to suppose that animals that do this might evolve standard procedures for doing it. So not only can they do this, but they can get their conspecifics to recognize what they're trying to tell them. And there's a name for that in English. They introduce conventions. They have conventions whereby if you perform a certain type of act, you raise your arm, then that is a signal that such and such is the case. You don't just have speaker meaning, but if it is to be effective over a period of time, if it's to function in the life of the community, the organisms, then there have to be recognizable procedures by which people can impose conditions of satisfaction on conditions of satisfaction. And those, I want to say, are meaning conventions. All right, so now we've taken two steps on the road to language. We've got speaker meaning, the intentional imposition of conditions of satisfaction on conditions of satisfaction. And we've also got this second feature, the introduction of conventional devices for doing that. Now, which comes first, the meaning or the convention? I want to see how much time I left myself just over the line. Which comes first? The acts of meaning or the convention? Well, you're not going to get very far without conventions. But I think, logically speaking, you have to see meaning as prior to convention, because the conventions have to have something to operate on. There has to be a convention that such and such counts as a certain creation of a speaker meaning. But so far, supposing we got this, suppose our animals have evolved this, they still don't have any structure. All of these are one-word sentences that they've evolved, such as danger or fire or rain or food. They've got these one-word sentences, but now how do we break them up? How do they acquire structures and segmentations? And there, it seems to me, the features of consciousness that we identified come to our rescue, because we saw two remarkable features of consciousness. One is they already come with their conditions of satisfaction intact. They're not, you don't have a problem about well, what does it seem to me that I'm seeing? It seems to me I'm seeing my hand in front of my face. But at the same time, though you've got a unity of the conditions of satisfaction, you've got a salience of actual objects and their features. And once you recognize the salience of the objects that you see and the features that those objects have, then you have a device which provides you with a tool on which with a tool out of which you can create reference and predication. You can create elements that are used to refer to an object, the same object or the same type of object, something corresponding to names and general nouns. But furthermore, you can introduce devices that will mark the features of those objects and indeed changing features of those objects. See, here is one of the things that has always puzzled me about language. Why do we break up reality the way we do? We can easily imagine completely different. As it happens, we have an object with this thing. I can't lift it off, but imagine that I could. And then we have an object for this other thing here. But we don't have a name for this thing. I'll draw a line there. Okay. We do not have a name for that nice object that I just created. Now, it'd be very easy to imagine a language that did have names for objects like that. We call that a turd. And we will suppose that turds are a very special religious significance. So if you break a turd by moving a part of it, you get the death penalty. Turds can only be constructed by sacred virgins working under water. And of course, there are words in our language that do have similar types of arbitrariness. But it's a distinct oddity for our language to imagine words that break up reality that way. We could have one word for the top half of the tree and another word for the bottom. We don't have that. Now, why not? Well, the answer is that our pre-linguistic experience, and particularly our relation causally to our environment, identifies discrete units of space and time, material objects, as naturally salient in our conscious experience. So it's very natural to suppose, I don't think we're cheating when we suppose, that the creatures who've got speaker meaning and conventions can then evolve internal structures whereby they introduce expressions that can refer to recurring objects in their environment. And they introduce expressions that can describe features of objects in their environment. But now once you've got that, so and I'll just say this, we got three things here. We got meaning, conventions, and now we've got internal structure. And the internal structure is built on the pre-linguistic structure of conscious experience, which makes continuing material objects together with their features salient. Now that seems to me a remarkable addition, and it explains, if I'm right so far, it explains two things that have always puzzled philosophers, at least have always puzzled me. How can it be the case that the sentence is unified if the sentence is made of discrete elements? How do you get the unity of the proposition out of all these discrete elements? Why isn't the sentence just a jumble of words? And the answer to that is to see that you don't make the sentence by combining words together, but you should think of the proposition expressed by the sentence as primary. That is the thing that determines the condition of satisfaction in primary, and then think of the words as derived by extracting that from the expression of the proposition. See, Frege said that 150 years ago. He said, only in the context of a sentence does a word have meaning. I won't display my bad German, but in any case, that was Frege's idea. He said we shouldn't think of the sentence as made by combining the words, but we should think of the words as what you get when you take the sentence apart.
Now, when I was an undergraduate, I thought that's the dumbest thing I ever heard of. Somebody said you shouldn't think of the car as what you get by putting the parts together, but you should think of the parts as what you get if you take the car apart. I couldn't hear any difference. But I think at a deep level, as usual, Frege was right that we should take the Satz, and the, which in German is kind of ambiguous between sentence and proposition. You should take that as primary and see the words as contributing to the identity, to the content of that. So what we've got now is a solution to the problem of the unity of the proposition. And the solution to the problem is to see that the proposition is a form that the prelinguistic intentionality takes once it becomes conventionalized, once you have conventional devices that, as I said, are manipulable and controllable and are segmented and discrete. Once you have that, then those naturally, if you think of them, if you think of the proposition as given prior to language, then it has a natural unity, and the disunity is an illusion generated by the fact precisely that the structures are controllable and manipulable. But there's another feature of language that it seems to me this account, if it doesn't explain it, at least it points in the direction of an explanation. And that is, why is the subject-predicate structure, the noun-phrase-verb-phrase structure, so pervasive? Now, granted, there are all kinds of languages that mess around with it, ergative languages and so on, in all kinds of ways. And we all know what it's like to wait around forever for the Germans to get to the main verb. I mean, everybody knows the story about Mark Twain was on a train reading a book in German, and somebody said, he's about halfway through, somebody said, well, how do you like the book? And he said, I don't know, I haven't come to the verb yet. Granted, there are perverse, what I think of as perverse languages like that, but all the same, there is a pervasiveness of the subject, predicate, noun, phrase, verb, phrase structure, and that's not given to us by logic. We could easily imagine completely different syntactical forms, but I think you'll see that that comes very natural to us, given that the structure of our experiences makes objects and their features salient. But now look what we've done. We've introduced meaning, conventions, and internal structures, and I just scratched the surface. Now we're off and running, because now we can introduce numerals, we can introduce tenses of verbs, we can introduce a vocabulary of space and time, a modal vocabulary, and it looks like now you've got a capacity for thinking thoughts that the prelinguistic animal cannot begin to think. See, again, back to Gilbert. Gilbert can think someone is approaching the door, or he can think a thought that we would report by saying someone is approaching the door. But he cannot think, I sure wish 1,000 people were approaching the door, and besides, I'm bored with worrying about the damn door, let's go for a walk. He cannot have these types of thoughts that require manipulable structures. Now I want you to notice also, I've introduced an enormously important feature, and that is a beast that has all of that can lie. And that is an enormous and distinctive human capacity. Once you have the capacity for committing yourself to the truth, you also have the capacity for lying. And the capacity for lying is a strict consequence of the fact that you have a capacity for undertaking commitments. Because once you have an animal that is capable of undertaking commitments, you have an animal that is intentionally capable of undertaking commitments insincerely. And that's what a lie is. It is an insincere commitment. The truth. Okay, that's important, and I'm going to get to that in a couple of minutes, but let's see how far we've got so far. What I've said is, it's not a huge miracle to suppose that language could have evolved from prelinguistic cognitive capacities. It's easy, relatively easy, to see how you can get meaning, conventions, and internal structures by building on the prelinguistic cognitive capacities that the animal has. But now then, have we answered our question? Well, if we understand this what is language? If we understand it in a certain way, I think we have, but I think that there is a mistake that is standardly made in supposing that all we need then is
a compositionality, generativity, meaningful devices. And what I'm going to suggest now, and this is really one of the main points of this talk, is that if you understand this in a certain way, you will see that an animal that has these capacities has already the capacity for undertaking commitments. And it's precisely the point I was making earlier about you've got the capacity for lying. That only happens because you've got the capacity for undertaking a commitment. Now, what is going on in these cases? What is this commitment that I'm talking about? Well, if you have a conventional way of representing states of affairs, and a convention means not just that it's arbitrary, but it is recognized by the community, so that the recognition, the intentional invocation of the convention is an intention that involves the recognition of other people that you are invoking that convention, and that means that you are committed by that convention. Now, of course, just having a belief or a desire or an intention is already a kind of commitment, because if you have a belief, you're committed to its truth. If you have a desire, you're committed to wanting to get it satisfied. If you have an intention, you're committed to carrying it out. But the commitment involved in explicit performances according to conventions is much stronger than that. The guy who just thinks it might be raining is not committed in the way the guy who swears that it's raining, the guy who solemnly asserts that it's raining, that person undertakes a public commitment. Now, what is a commitment? What exactly is meant by saying that there is a commitment involved in these cases? And it seems to me that is where the notion of deontology that I was mentioning earlier comes in. That in the case of commitments, you create a species, you create something that is a general form of this species of deontology, something that involves obligations, requirements, duties, and so on. And all of those lock into human rationality, in that in every case you give yourself an inclination or desire independent reason for doing something. See, when you make a statement, you are committed to the truth of that statement. And that means that it's not enough to say, oh, well, I was just stating. It's a free country. I was just stating. I mean, an American politician, when asked about something, once said, well, I was just lying. But that did not get him off the hook. You know, I said, I was just scratching my head, or I forgot that it was Wednesday or something like that. And the reason that we think there's something wrong about that, there's something that is absurd about that, is that the fact that you are stating already involves the undertaking. If a commitment undertakes of an obligation, acceptance of a duty, and in the case of statements, there are three obligations involved. If it's a solemn statement, you're committed to its truth. You're committed to believing its truth. That's a sincerity condition on the Speech Act. And you're committed to giving reason, to being able to give reasons for believing that it's true. People think that you can just say anything and mean anything and so on, but that's not really the case. Austin had a good example. Suppose I now say, there are exactly 17 people in the next room. And you say, well, how do you know? It's not enough for me to say, oh, it's just a statement. I mean, if I say, I think there are exactly 17 people, then I undertake a commitment to answer certain kinds of questions. Okay, now that's the first step that I want to get to, and that is, deontology is built into language. You cannot explain the structure and functioning of language without introducing the deontology. But now that immediately has an interesting consequence. Once you have the capacity for undertaking commitments of these kinds, then you have, and you have together that with compositionality, you have this compositional character of language, then you have a capacity, and I think it's just inevitable that you should have this. You have a capacity for creating a social reality by representing it as existing. Now, let me explain how that evolves. The most primitive forms of human society will be natural extensions of pre-linguistic social arrangements. The beast lives in his or her dwelling, recognizes a status hierarchy in the tribe, and recognizes the partner in its pair bonding. Now, when you've got that, you don't yet have private property, government, and marriage. But the next step is to introduce language. Because once the beast can say, this is my house, that's my woman, he is our leader, then you've got something more than just the capacity to represent pre-existing states of affairs. Those utterances already carry the deontology of truth-telling, but then implicit in them is a deontology that involves this other direction of fit. Because if the beast can, I might as well call them humans, I mean, they're not just any old beast. If the human being can say, this is my house, then that doesn't just describe a pre-existing relation, but it lays a claim. It claims that I have a right, notice this vocabulary, I have a right to that house that other people don't have. And if you can get other people to accept that you have that right, then you have created a social reality that did not exist in the pre-linguistic form. Because if other people grant you that you have the right and you've laid claim to that right, then they have a desire independent or an inclination independent reason for respecting or granting that right. And I want to say this seems... Oh, sorry.
No, it's not. You can finish the sentence.